talk a little bit about meal planning and get into that element of better eating. Many of you have probably made New Year's resolutions for better eating. So that's what we're gonna talk today, see what we can do to help you eat better this year. So Courtney, tell us a little bit about yourself, what you do on kind of a day-to-day basis.
So I'm an outpatient dietitian here at the medical center, and so I see patients during the day for individual counseling sessions, and then I also teach classes in the evening for our Way to Health weight management program. And one of the topics that we include in our classes is menu planning, because we know that that's such an important piece of eating healthy and losing weight or maintaining a healthy weight.
Okay, and that's exactly what we're going to talk about today is meal planning, and it sounds like you on a pretty regular basis or talking with patients about how they can eat better. So let's dive right in. If you do have questions, you can post it on our Facebook page for Intermountain Medical Center. So if you go to facebook.com/Intermountain Medical Center, you'll find our Facebook page and there's a post there. You can post your question there. We'll be fielding those. Unfortunately, our telephone lines aren't working today, so we're not able to do call-in questions, but go ahead and post it on the Facebook feed and we will get to your questions during the broadcast. So let's start with kind of four tips. Where can people start? Why meal planning?
So meal planning is something that's so important, and I always like to start out my class on meal planning on talking about why do we recommend meal planning. So the first reason would be to cut down on eating out. So as Americans, we're eating out a lot. We're eating out multiple meals a day or definitely multiple times a week. And if we look at the data back from 1929, 1930s, we were eating out for special occasions every once in a while. And now we're spending about half of our food budget on eating out. And so it's become a lot more expensive for us, and there's health consequences. Our waistlines are expanding, our wallet's shrinking. And so for one reason, meal planning is important because it can help decrease the frequency with which you're eating out. Okay. Now, when you're eating out, we know that you don't have control over portion sizes, you don't have control over the ingredients that they're cooking with, and so we know that you're gonna be getting more sugar, more sodium, more saturated fat, just more calories in general, and you can't control the ingredients that they're cooking with. And so when you're using recipes and cooking at home, they don't often call for deep fat fryers and trans fats and high fructose corn syrup. And so when we're cooking at home, we can control our cooking methods, we can control our ingredients and our portion sizes.
Okay, some good points. And I eat out frequently probably because I need the meal planning, because during the week for lunch, it's easy just to pop out and grab something. And so, but like you said, I don't know what exactly it is they're cooking, what processes they're going through. I just know kind of what I'm eating. So. Okay, definitely.
And along that line of saving time, meal planning, it seems like it takes more time. You have to find recipes and grocery shop and cook. But if you plan ahead and you make extra portions on the weekends and you prep, wash, and chop vegetables, you can really save time during the week, but it does require that planning ahead. So a little bit more effort and time up front, but you save time during the week.
Okay, and that ties into one of the questions that one of our Facebook folks asked. Heidi was talking about, you know, what are some general tips, which we're gonna get into, but what she was specifically asking about is an example of, say on Monday night, you wanna cook chicken. So you cook a bunch of chicken, you maybe don't eat it all, or maybe you cook more than you're gonna eat that night to use it for later in the week, maybe the next day to put on a salad. Is that kind of what meal planning is, and is that beneficial?
Exactly. So you can definitely save a lot of time if you plan out for the week. On Monday night, I want to have chicken fajitas, but on Tuesday night, I'm going to make chicken noodle soup, and on Thursday, I'm going to make some whole wheat pesto pasta with chicken. You can make chicken for all of those meals on Monday or even on Sunday night and have everything prepped and ready to go for the week, so when you get home from work at 6 o'clock or 7, you don't have to get the chicken out, thaw it, cook it, it's ready to go.
And it holds up in the fridge for a couple of days?
So cooked meat, probably 2 to 3 days would be the max. You could also cook it, chop it up, and freeze it, and then just put it in the fridge in the morning when you leave for work, and it should be ready to go in the evening.
Okay, that's a good tip, because I don't want chicken to sit in the fridge for too long and then get nervous and throw it away, and then there goes the plan for that night. So.
Well, and that's the other thing. If you are going to be grocery shopping for the entire week, you can also plan your meals around timing. So if you want to use your fresh produce in the first few days of the week so that it's fresh and it doesn't spoil, you can plan on frozen fruits and vegetables, frozen fish for later in the week. So that can save time at the store and ensure that you're not wasting fresh fruits and vegetables and meat.
Okay, good point. So let's kind of walk through, got some questions here that I can ask, but one of the first ones, how many times a week do we go out and head to a vending machine for an afternoon snack?
Yeah, and so that's something that I always like to ask people when we're having this conversation of meal planning, because when you're not planning ahead, you usually end up at the drive-thru or the vending machine, and again, you're gonna be spending more money, you're gonna have more calories, you're gonna have larger portion sizes, not as healthy of ingredients. And so we are definitely eating out a lot more often than we should be. Instead of a special occasion, it's almost a daily thing.
Okay. One of the things that I'm noticing in some of our conversation is eating out obviously isn't the healthiest, but it's also a little more expensive. So by meal planning, you can not only eat better, but you can save money. Is that something you've seen or noticed with people in meal planning?
Yes, and that's something that I think people still have conflicting thoughts about. You know, you can take your family to McDonald's and order off the dollar menu, and it seems really inexpensive. But Mark Bittman is a contributing author for the New York Times, and he's very interested in food and health, and he actually looked into this. And for a family of four, he looked at roasting a chicken, making a salad, some vegetables, and a glass of milk for each person in the family. Cost about $14 just at a regular grocery store, the ingredients. And he also looked at taking a family of four to McDonald's and ordering Big Macs, French fries, soda, chicken McNuggets, kind of the usual. And that bill ended up being about $28. And so he actually decided he needed to prove to Americans it can be cheaper to go to the grocery store and cook and not eat out, even if you're going to fast food restaurants.
Okay, so there's a financial benefit in addition to the health benefits for yourself.
Yeah. Okay. And when you're at the store, one of the things that you can do with meal planning and planning ahead is you can look at the coupons, what's on sale. If you go to the store and you're flexible and you see that chicken's on sale that week, you could switch it up to chicken instead of doing salmon or tilapia or something that you had planned. And then with fruits and vegetables, that's one place where people often find that their bill gets expensive at the grocery store. If you're shopping in season, the fruits and vegetables are going to be a lot less expensive. If you're trying to get strawberries in January, they're going to be very expensive because they're not in season. They're coming from South America. And so they're going to be expensive. They're not going to be as nutritious because they were picked a few weeks ago and flown up here and been in the grocery store for a while. And so buying in season is going to save you money. Also, frozen fruits and vegetables and proteins are a great option. And sometimes people think that frozen is less nutritious or not as healthy as fresh. And that is definitely a myth that I always like to educate people on. Actually, if you're going to buy strawberries, say in January, the strawberries are picked and frozen immediately, so they're at their peak of their freshness. They're most nutritious then. They have the most vitamins and minerals at that time. Whereas if they're picked in Chile and transported up here, they could be weeks old by the time they get to you. So they're actually not as fresh. They've lost some nutrition value in that time. So frozen is a less expensive option a lot of times, still just as nutritious, sometimes more nutritious.
Okay, good to know. So it looks like we have a question from Danny that posted on our Facebook page. And again, if you have a question for Courtney, go ahead and post it on our Facebook page, facebook.com/Intermountain Medical Center. You'll find the post on it, and we'll go ahead and answer Danny's question. So his is, what kind of foods are good to pack if I'm always on the go? I think a lot of people can relate to that.
Yeah, that's a tough one. So you either have to find non-perishable quick options that you can bring with you, or you could get an insulated lunchbox or little cooler and bring ice packs so that you could bring some perishable options as well. But one of the things that we talk about in meal planning is having your staples. So having staples in your pantry, in your fridge, and in your freezer. And so the staples for your pantry would be things like nuts. So you could get almonds, walnuts. You could get dried fruit like apricots, mangoes. You could make a trail mix. That way would be a healthy balanced snack of carbohydrate and protein. You could get some whole wheat crackers and a string cheese that could be out of the fridge for a few hours safely. You could even do a yogurt, a Greek yogurt, or just a regular low-fat yogurt. One thing that I've done in the past is if you freeze a container of yogurt and then pull it out of the freezer in the morning, it will thaw out during the day and you can have it later on.
Okay, that's a good tip. I've never tried that before, so. And I know as far as eating on the go, you know, at work a lot of times I don't plan ahead, and so I'm at work and lunchtime comes and I swing across the street to grab something, you know, at one of the fast food places that are nearby. And so yeah, that was a great question, Danny, on kind of staples that even I can have with me when I come to work so that when lunchtime rolls around, I don't have to swing across the street.
Yeah, and that's, you bring up another great point for meal planning, because if you are cooking a healthy dinner the night before and you make some extra portions and you put a serving size into a Tupperware container and put it in the fridge, in the morning when you're rushing out the door and trying to get kids off to school and really busy, all you have to do is grab that Tupperware and you have a nutritious lunch to take with you that doesn't require a lot of prep time or planning or anything. You just have leftovers for lunch the next day, so that can help.
Okay, that's good to know. Now, we've talked about some of the benefits of it. It saves you money, eat a little bit healthier. How does it help with weight management?
That's a great question. There's been actually some research studies that have looked at this, and there was a study published in the International Journal of Obesity and Metabolic Disorders, and they found that when they gave patients or participants in the study a structured meal plan with recipes and a grocery shopping list, that they were more successful with weight loss. They found that their eating habits improved, they were eating breakfast, lunch, and dinner, they were incorporating lean proteins, whole grains, more fruits and vegetables, and they were more successful with weight loss during the study.
Okay. So meal planning can definitely play an important role then in weight management. My wife does a lot of the dinner cooking and takes care of that, and so she kind of handles that meal planning, so I really don't know how to really get started with meal planning. What would you recommend if for me or anybody else that's watching, what's the first step I should take when it comes to meal planning? Yes, I want to eat healthier this year, but I don't really know where to start.
That's a great question. So there's two techniques that you can use. One would be the ingredient method and one would be the recipe method. Both can be very effective. It just depends on your style and what suits you best. And so with the ingredient method, you would just buy the staples. So you would have your whole grains, your olive oil, your brown rice, quinoa, chicken broth, pantry staples. You would fill up your fridge with fruits and vegetables and lean proteins, low-fat dairy, and then you could even put some fruits and vegetables and meat in the freezer. Then during the week, you get home and you decide, oh, I really feel like having tacos tonight. Then you have all the staples that you need. You can throw together some tacos. So that's the best method if you like to be more creative, don't necessarily like too much structure, you don't always follow recipes. And one thing that people often say is, if I plan out recipes for the whole week and I get home on Wednesday night and I don't feel like having what I had planned, I'm gonna waste the ingredients. And so if you're one of those people that likes to get home and decide what you're in the mood for, then the ingredient method would be best. Okay. The other method is the recipe method. So that's where you would sit down on a Saturday or Sunday when you've got more time and find recipes that you want to make for the week. So you would choose your recipes for each night, you'd create a grocery shopping list, go to the store, get everything that you need. When you come home from the store on weekends, if you have more time, you can wash and chop and prepare fruits and vegetables. You could cook brown rice or chicken, get everything kind of ready for the week. And then you know each night when you come home what recipe you're going to make. And so that's for people who like more structure, like to follow recipes. And I know that that can be a little intimidating starting out if you haven't done any meal planning. Mm-hmm. You know, to try to plan out 7 nights a week seems overwhelming. So if you just maybe pick 2 or 3 nights of the week to start out with and then build upon that,
okay,
that's kind of the best way to start. Other tips that are helpful with the recipe method is if you feel like it's really difficult to find recipes or figure out what's for dinner each night, you can come up with a 2-week menu rotation of your favorite recipes. So, you know, your family favorites, your favorites, and you could just kind of rotate through those recipes every 2 weeks or so. So you don't have to reinvent the wheel all the time.
Yeah.
And then another thing that a lot of people like, especially kids, is having theme nights. So if you say it's Taco Tuesday night, every Tuesday you know you're going to be having tacos, and you can make variations. You could do, you know, black bean brown rice or chicken. So you, it doesn't have to be the same thing every week, but you can have a calendar up with your theme nights, and then everyone can get excited for Taco Tuesday.
Maybe wear sombreros that night,
yeah,
too, or something. Really get
into
the
really
theme
festive.
Of it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one of the things you mentioned, I'd probably go the recipe approach because I'm maybe not as creative when it comes to whipping up a meal. How do you find good recipes? I mean, I know in our cupboard we have probably 60, it seems like, recipe books.
Right.
A ton of different things. How do you find a good recipe to know that it's got the ingredients in it that will be better for you?
Be healthy, right. So there's 2 websites that I send my patients to to look for new recipes. My favorite is eatingwell.com.
Okay.
So it's actually a magazine that you can subscribe to and get in the mail, but you can also get all of their recipes for free online, which is kind of nice. They have 30-minute meals on there, so if you want something quick and easy, you can search for 30-minute meals. They also include all of the nutrition facts in their recipes. So if you're counting calories or carbohydrates, it gives you all of that information.
Okay.
Cookinglight.com is another one that is a website and a magazine.
Okay.
And so when you're kind of feeling like you're in a recipe rut or you don't know what to fix, I think it's really fun to get a magazine in the mail every month, and I sit down and I pick out 1 or 2 new recipes that I want to try out. The great thing about those magazines is usually everything is in season. So in the winter time, they're going to have winter squash and Brussels sprouts and fruits and vegetables that are in season. And so that helps you save money at the store and get the most nutritious fruits and vegetables of the season.
Okay. So that was eatingwell.com and cookinglight.com that have all those recipes. Okay.
Yeah.
One of the things you mentioned, as far as the recipe goes, they have 30-minute recipes. I would think that would be one of the reasons why a lot of people don't meal plan or just kind of eat on the fly, is they just don't have the time. What sort of tips would you offer to somebody who thinks they don't have the time to do this to maybe help them save time in doing it?
Yeah, exactly. So you want to keep your schedule and time constraints in mind when you're meal planning. So for most of us, on the weekends, we have more time where we can find recipes, we can grocery shop. One thing I like to do when I have time on Saturday or Sunday is get out my produce, wash and chop everything, cook a bunch of brown rice or whole wheat pasta. So get things ready for the week when you've got more time. And then the other thing is on weeknights, keeping it really simple. So finding really simple, quick, easy recipes, nothing that requires crazy cooking techniques or a lot of time, because when you get home from work, you're not going to want to spend, you know, a bunch of time in the kitchen. And so if you plan ahead and you've grocery shopped and you have all the ingredients that you need, that saves a lot of time on weeknights. So you don't have to go to the store and then go home and try to cook. If you have all the ingredients ready, that helps a lot. And then the other tip I personally think is so important is to clean up as you go. If you are done with a busy day at work and you've just cooked this nice meal for your family and you sit down and eat together and then you get up and you have a mess in the kitchen, that makes cooking not very fun.
Agreed.
And so if you can try to clean as you go, that helps a lot so you don't have a mess at the end. Or if you can get your family involved and have your kids maybe help with some of the cooking or cleaning as you go, that can make things a lot easier at the end of the meal.
So put your kids to work, have them clean up the kitchen after you, right?
Or have them help with the cooking.
Even better.
Or have them help with picking out recipes as well. Because I know a lot of people say, oh, my kids won't eat that. They're very picky. They don't like fruits and vegetables. And a lot of times, if you can get them involved in the process, if they pick out a recipe they want to try, if you go to the grocery store and say, okay, pick out one new fruit and one new vegetable that you want to try this week, and you get them involved in the cooking process, so safely, you know, monitor knives and things like that. But if you can teach them cooking skills and teach them about how to create a healthy meal, and you teach them that it's important to sit down as a family for dinner, those are really important skills for them to have from a young age. Usually, if they're involved in the process, they're more likely to at least try what's on their plate.
Okay. Some good points.
Yeah.
So we're going to go ahead and take a quick 1 minute break. Again, if you have questions, submit it on our Facebook page, facebook.com/Intermountain Medical Center. We'll answer those questions as soon as we come back. Just a short break. We'll come back and talk about kind of general tips for eating healthier beyond meal planning, things to look for. So see you back in just a moment. Okay, so that was kind of a funny video we did last year actually for Stroke Awareness Month, but I think it's got a really good message. The salt shaker that's made the decision of reducing the amount of salt that are in people's diets, because that's one of the things that can be unhealthy for us is having too much salt. So let's talk a little bit about that element of it. And one of the things that I understand, you can correct me if I'm wrong or misunderstand this, is when you go grocery shopping, it's really better to maybe stay on the outskirts of the grocery store. You've kind of got your frozen and your dairy and your meats and your deli and your fruits and vegetables on the outside. It's the inside where you get all your pre-processed, your canned food, and those can be high in salt.
Exactly.
Is that accurate?
Yes, okay. Exactly. That's a great tip. When you're going to the grocery store, if you can stay in the perimeter, you're going to find your whole foods, fruits and vegetables, your proteins, your dairy, bread, grains. So you're finding the more whole, less processed foods. When you get into the middle of the grocery store where you have canned, packaged, frozen dinners, that's where you're going to find a lot of sodium. And as we know, having too much salt in our diet can be really detrimental for our heart health and can contribute to high blood pressure.
Okay. One of the things you mentioned, heart health, and I'm just going to kind of throw this out there. Next Saturday, a week from this Saturday, we have a heart fair here at Intermountain Medical Center. You can get more details on our website, intermountainmedicalcenter.org. But we have a cooking demo as part of that. And so we have somebody that's going to come and share some healthy recipes. So great opportunity there. What are some other tips that you would offer as far, you know, maybe cooking oils, or what are other things we can do to eat healthier in general as we're selecting the right ingredients?
Yeah, so along those same lines of the cooking demo at the Heart Health Fair, one thing that the chef is probably going to do is talk about cooking with herbs and spices. So when you're taking away some of the salt in your diet, especially when you're cooking at home, you might find that you've lost some of the flavor in your foods. And so if you can experiment with more herbs and spices in your cooking, you can get great flavors that way without adding salt.
Okay. It's good to know. And then cooking oils. You know, do you use butter to grease the pan? Do you use Pam? What are some substitutes maybe or kind of a best practice for healthier eating?
Yeah, so that's a question that always comes up in the classes that I teach. And I actually teach a class over at Cardiac Rehab. And we spend a lot of time talking about what type of fats to cook with because the type of fat that you choose can have an effect on your heart health. And so you can break down fats into three broad categories. Your unsaturated, your saturated, and your trans fats. So your unsaturated fats are going to be considered heart healthy. And the reason is that they lower the bad cholesterol or your LDL cholesterol levels. So unsaturated fats are going to come mainly from plants. So olive oil, canola oil, peanut butter, nuts and seeds, avocados, those are all going to be great sources of unsaturated fat. So for cooking, your fats are going to be liquid at room temperature, olive oil, canola oil. The saturated fat is going to be less heart healthy because it's going to raise your bad cholesterol or your LDL cholesterol levels. So you just want to limit the amount of saturated fat in your diet. Saturated fat is found in animal products mainly, so your butter, your cheeses, whole milk. On meat where you see visible fat, that's all gonna be saturated fat. So mainly from animals. Now, right now in the nutrition world, coconut oil is a big thing and kind of a hot topic. And coconut oil is not from animals, it's actually a tropical oil, but it is a saturated fat. And so that's one that we wouldn't consider as heart healthy as olive oil or canola oil for cooking with.
Okay. It's good to know.
And then the last category, the trans fats, that is the one that we want to completely avoid in our diet. Okay. And the reason is because trans fats, they increase your bad cholesterol or your LDL levels. They also lower your HDL cholesterol, your good cholesterol. So we want to keep our HDL levels high because they protect our heart health. And so we want to do everything we can to avoid those trans fats in our diet. Now, trans fats are man-made, so they're going to be in margarine, in frosting, in pastries, in baked goods, in fast food. So you're going to find them all in processed and packaged foods.
Okay. So those Twinkies that you want to eat, that those fall into that category?
Yes, okay. Yes, and a lot of margarines. And so people always ask, should I use margarine? Should I use butter? What's better? And so if your margarine has trans fats in it, that's not going to be a good choice. So butter would actually be better than a margarine with trans fats in it. You can find margarines that are just made with vegetable oils and don't have trans fats in them, but you have to read the ingredient list. So they can trick you. If you just look at the front of the package, it might say no trans fats or 0 grams of trans fat, but they can get away with that if it has less than half of a gram per serving. And so you want to read the ingredient list and look for hydrogenated or partially hydrogenated oils. That's a trans fat. Okay. So if you see that in the ingredients of your margarine, your crackers, your cookies, frosting, anything like that, you want to try to avoid those products.
Okay, good points. So we only have a couple minutes left. If you were to sum up everything that we've talked about into maybe a couple key takeaways, what would those be?
Yeah, so that's a good question. Now that we've talked about so many different topics, meal planning, salt, cooking oils, butter, all of that, I think the best way to tie everything together is with a visual. Okay. And that visual is called the plate method. And I'll show you just an example of what the plate method looks like here. And we can put this up online for you as well. But the plate method basically shows you how should you structure your meals. And so it gives you a picture of a plate and it shows that half your plate is going to be full of fruits and vegetables, a quarter is going to be a whole grain or a starch, a quarter is going to be a lean protein. Okay. So in that way, you're meeting your nutrient needs for your carbohydrate, your protein, and your fats, and you have lots of colorful fruits and vegetables in there, which are going to give you vitamins, minerals, antioxidants.
Okay. That's a great point. And that document that she showed, we will share the link to that once we get it posted on the Facebook post that we have where you're asking your questions. So stay tuned there and we'll get that posted. Great information today, and I appreciate everything that you shared on it. Hopefully I can be better at eating during the day, because my wife does great with us eating at night. But during the day, you know, rather than eating out, a lot of great tips on that. So stay tuned for our next webcast that we'll announce on the website in the coming weeks, centered around heart health. And again, appreciate the time, and we will see all of you next time.